So the next speaker will be Ole Jensen, and he comes from the Center of Human Brain Health from the University of Birmingham. So his title is Coupling Between Frontal Gamma and Posterior Alpha Oscillations, Supporting Language Prediction.
Yeah. First, thank you very much for the invitation to come here and present some of our new data. So far, this has been an excellent workshop, and I think we are going to learn a lot in the future also from this sort of bringing language research together with system neuroscience. So these are very exciting times. So my first disclaimer is that I'm not really a psycholinguist. But what I've done is to put on the same shirt as David, so at least I hope to gain some credibility that way. The second disclaimer is that we have somewhat changed the scope of this presentation in the light of some new data we have, but we believe we now have evidence for prediction during language comprehension. And I should say that this work here mainly has been done by Lin Wang. She's now at Tufts University, also affiliated with MGH Harvard. And we are also working tightly together with Gina Kuberberg on these studies. So what we have been looking into recently is predictions. And there's quite a nice recent review paper by Gina Kuberberg talking about predictions at different levels in the language system. Over the years, as you probably are aware, a lot of work has been done to look into predictions and also pre-activation. So it's a very strong notion in the field of language research. Many of these studies are, however, not based on looking at the, say, brain activity prior to a predicted word, but rather to look at violations to predictions. And I'll just show you an example here. It's a study from De Long, in which they have been presenting sentences, and the last word could then be predicted. What they did here, the innovation of this study, was to look at articles preceding the last word. And now it turns out that if there's a violation to the prediction of not only the word, but thus also the article, you see a stronger in 400. Down here, right? So this is one of the studies that has been used to argue for prediction going on during language processing. Nevertheless, this study has recently been criticized in a not very subtle paper, who then were not able to reproduce these findings. And furthermore, this paper then brought into question to what extent predictions is going on sort of more generally, or they argue maybe we should sort of limit the role of prediction in language comprehension. So I'm not going to take any stake in this debate. I just want to argue here that prediction is a strong notion within language research, but it's also a notion that has received some criticism. So basically, we don't know how strongly to weigh this notion of prediction. So the scope of the study I'm going to show you now is to, as I mentioned before, to go in and look at the brain activity associated with prediction. But what we are doing here is that we are looking at the brain activity prior to the onset of the predicted word. And we are going to make use of representational similarity analysis to do that. And we have been using MEG to approach this. So the logic of the experiment is very simple somehow. So basically what we are doing, we are presenting sentences where the last word can be predicted. In the crib there is a sleeping baby, right? In the hospital there is a newborn. You would also predict baby here, but for reasons I'm not going to get into, we actually put in another concrete word. But the key point being is that we have sentence or sentence pairs in which exactly the same word is going to be predicted. And we can then contrast that to sentences where a different word is going to be predicted, right? So the logic of the analysis is now to look at the correlatedness of the brain activity between the within pairs in which the same words were predicted and compare that to correlations in brain activity where different words were predicted, right? So in fact, this is super simple. There's nothing complicated about it. We're simply looking at these correlations for within versus between. And then we are presenting the sentences at a relatively slow rate, so 200 milliseconds per item, and then the inter-item interval was 800 milliseconds. So this is admittedly a bit slow, but we can discuss that later, right? We also did visual presentation. In order to have a robust study, we recorded MEG data from 32 subjects, and each subject were presented 120 sentence pairs. And since Lin Wang did the study in Beijing, these were Chinese participants, and of course the sentences were in Chinese. And as I mentioned before, the analysis is quite straightforward. The first part of the analysis, we are looking at spatial correlations. Basically, we look at the sensor activity, and then we do a dot product over the sensors from the two sensor activity from the two trials here, right? It's as simple as that. So basically, this is the case where the same word is going to be predicted, and then time point by time point, we simply look at the correlations or sensors, and we contrast that then to the correlations for the cases where different words were going to be predicted. And then we are going to look for more within correlations as compared to the between correlations, right? So when we do this, the data comes out the following. So I'll just walk you through it. So basically at time zero, this is when the last word is going to be predicted, like baby, and this is the second last word onset here at time minus one. And then we see these correlations going up and down, right? So the larger deflections on these correlations are most likely going to reflect evoked responses that more or less looks the same in these conditions. But what you should appreciate here is the difference between the correlations for the within pair versus the between pair. And what you see is that there's a systematic difference. And then we simply can do, at this case, a t-test for the time window where we have the strongest correlations, and we find that there is a significantly stronger within pair versus between pair correlation. So basically, this is what I came to say. So we now believe that we have some evidence for a neuronal activity reflecting prediction going on in this language context. What you should also appreciate is that this prediction occurs quite early, right? So this is the second to the last word that allows you to predict the word here at time zero. So as soon as you can make the prediction, the brain activity reflects that is being done. And furthermore, we actually don't see too much predictive activity in the interval between the two words. So that's another important thing to keep in mind. Okay, another way to substantiating the robustness of this is to look at the correlations values for within pair versus between pairs. And each dot here represents a subject. And if a subject is below the diagonal, it suggests that there's, or it shows that there's stronger within pair compared to between pair correlation, right? And you can see for the greater majority of these 32 subjects, they are below the diagonal. So this is a fairly robust effect. So now I've told you about the correlations. We can do time point by looking at the correlations or sensors. What we also can do is to look at the correlations over time. And this is illustrated here. So basically, what we can do is to cut out a snippet of data, right? And then we can go into a given sensor, or we can go into a given, say, location in the brain, and apply a spatial filter to that location. And for these snippets of data, now we can look at the correlation over time, and again compare the within to the between correlations. And that's going to give us some spatial information, supposedly, about where these correlations are. And we did this for the time window, where we saw the strongest correlations for both within and between pairs. And when first considering the sensor level data, what we then see is that comparing within to between pair, we see an increase in the correlations over the posterior part of the brain. However, with beamforming analysis, we can do this much better. And when doing that, quite a surprise came out. So basically, what these color codes here reflects is the difference in correlations for predicted versus unpredicted pairs. And what you should appreciate is that is in the left MTL and some other neighboring regions that we see this predictive effect, right? So I'm later going to discuss what the hippocampus slash MTL might be doing here. So now you might go in and ask, what about brain oscillations? Because it's the theme of this workshop, right? So of course, what we tried to do was to go in and first of all do the time frequency representations of these trials. So we just looked at the power and then see if we could find these predictive effects. And the answer is no. So just by looking at oscillatory power or amplitude, we are not able to get the fingerprint of these predictions. So of course, what this suggests is that it's the phase relationship between these signals or the fields measured by MEG. It's the phase relationship in which the information is contained. What we also did was to try different bandpass filters in the theta, alpha, beta rings, and so forth, to see if you could get some specificity to the prediction. But there were some subtle differences, but nothing really came out robust. So basically, this is an effect that we see in a broadband rings from low pass filter at 30 hertz. But what we could do was to go in and look at different trials with different levels of power, right? So the logic is the following. What we do is that we look at all the trials, and then we sort the trial pairs according to low power or high power, right? Per subject, and then we do a median split, right? So it's a bit complicated because we have two sentences, but we just look at the sum power for two trial pairs. And what you then should appreciate is that when the alpha activity is high, we don't see this predictive effect. However, when the alpha activity is low, we see the predictive effect. So this is consistent with the notion that these oscillations in the alpha band supposedly is doing some sort of functional inhibition. However, when the alpha is low, more commutation, if you will, is allowed. And in this case, prediction can occur, and it reveals itself in these correlational measures. So the first interim conclusion for this part of the study is that, yes, we now think we have evidence for prediction going on in a language task as identified by a representational similarity analysis. When we consider the spatial correlations, we can tell when in time these predictions occur, and the message is like as early as possible, right? When it's as early as possible. And the second point is we can ask where in the brain does this occur, and it seems to be that the left MTL is dominating this. Of course, since we are dealing with MEG, we also have the inverse problem. So when I say the left MTL slash hippocampus, you should take that with a grain of salt, right? What we hope to do in the long run is to confirm these findings by intracranial recordings. And the last part of this part of the talk is that when we see these predictions, that typically occurs when the alpha power is low. So I'm now going to show you a second study that Lin Wang has been doing. So in this study, we did another somehow simple manipulation, and that was simply to manipulate the sentence context, right? So here's just two examples. He gave her a necklace for her birthday. That's high constraining that most people would have predicted birthday to occurring when hearing the sentence context. The low constraining sentence is he gave her a ticket for her birthday. Not many people would have predicted birthday, but all kind of words, right? So basically, again, we are going to look at the brain activity associated with prediction. Of course, in this case, we can not look at representational specific predictions, but we can still sort of look at the brain activity in the network associated with being in the predictive mode. First of all, if you just do the time frequency representation of power of these data, what you should appreciate is that over the back of the head, we see the typical alpha band activity, right? So even though you get bombarded with these words, it's not that the alpha activity is gone. It's still the strongest dominating rhythm in the spectrum. There's some dips in the alpha activity each time a word has occurred. Now, the magic happens when we compare the highly compared to the lowly constraining sentences. And what we see is that when you can predict a word coming up, there seems to be a depression in the alpha band. Furthermore, this is left lateralized. And since we are doing MEG, we can also localize the sources of this effect. And when we do that, lo and behold, what we see is that when you can predict the upcoming word, there seems to be a depression in the alpha band in sort of Broca's and Wernicke type of areas, right? So it is the alpha activity in the left language system being associated with the prediction, and even that source here also bleeds into the left MTL, right? So for people like me looking at alpha activity, this is quite exciting in the sense that we have been doing a lot of work in the visual system and the somatosensory system, and I think we have a pretty good case that when alpha goes down, that reflects processing. And if alpha goes up, that reflects disengagement. Now, this data here suggests that this functional role of the alpha activity in terms of allocating computational resources also generalized to the language system. Furthermore, it's also consistent with our previous finding, namely that when alpha activity goes down, that is when predictions can occur. So, I'm now going to switch gears to some discussion points, and that is to discuss the role of the hippocampus or the medial temporal lobe in language tasks in general. So over the years, there have been some debate to whether the hippocampus is involved in language comprehension and production. And I guess the sort of going notion is that patients like HM having MTL lesions still can do language tasks pretty well, right? So there has not been too much interest from language researchers on the hippocampus. But I think the tide is changing. So I was discussing this with Vittoria Pia, and I think tomorrow she's also going to show some intracranial data from hippocampal recordings. And she pointed me to this paper here by Kloster and Duff. And what they have been doing is to look into patients that have MTL lesions. And it actually turns out that these patients do seem to have semantic memory deficits in language tasks. So this is, for instance, association tasks and so forth, where they seem to be impaired, right? So there are some reasons, evidence that the hippocampus could be much more involved in language tasks as previously has been appreciated. There's also some quite intriguing data from the rat hippocampus speaking to now sequences and predictions. And I will point you to some of those. So here's a study by John O'Keefe. So this is a study I've always admired a lot. In fact, I think John O'Keefe, he deserves a second Nobel Prize for this one. Because what he did was to record from a rat, right? And in the rat, as you all probably know, you see place cells. So when the rat is moving around the maze, you see, in this case, these small dots represents a cell firing in the hippocampus. So it fires when the rat is in this area, right? So it's called the place field. But what O'Keefe did was to look at this firing with respect to the phase of the ongoing theta oscillations. And in the red, these theta oscillations are so strong you can see them with the naked eye. And what you now should appreciate is that initially, late in the theta cycle, you see the firing occurring first, and then the firing advances to earlier and earlier phases of the theta cycle. So this is called the theta phase precession, right? So the key point here being that by looking at the phase of firing, you can get additional information about where the rad is, in the way that if the firing is early in the theta cycle, we know that the rad is in this end of the field rather than in at that end, right? And indeed, you can also try to reconstruct the rad's position, looking at multiple place cells, and you can confirm the case that, yes, we can get information out of phase of firing. Of course, the next question now is, like, how is this phase position generated, right? What sort of computations might it reflect? So when these data came out a good 20 years ago with John Lisman, we proposed a model for how the upcoming recall of predictive sequences, if you will, can account for the theta phase precession effect. So here's a little cartoon from our paper back then. So in fact, it's very simple. The rad is running through a maze. It's now here at location 2. The rad is thinking, maybe location 4 is coming up. So what might be going on at the neuronal level is that when the rad is at location 1, there's a sequence 1, 2, 3, 4, being read out, and of course each number here represents a spatial pattern reflecting the a given place representation, right? So basically when the rat is at location 1, 1, 2, 3, 4 is being read out, at location 2, 2, 2, 3, 4, 5 is being read out, and so forth, right? So if you now are the electrophysiologist recording from a place cell coding for location 4, what you initially will see is that the firing is occurring late, earlier, earlier, and earlier in the theta cycle, right? So this very simple model can account for the theta phase precession of John O'Keefe. Furthermore, it's quite easy to implement a little computational model that can do this, right? So this model is based on the recurrent collaterals of the CA3. You have in synaptic plasticity. This plasticity is asymmetric, so we present first location A1 and then location 2. Location 1 is going to be linked to location 2, such that later on, if you see location 1, there's a recall of location 2 and so forth, right? So there's a bunch of models out there making use of this asymmetric LTP to encode sequences, and these models can then, of course, also later when probe, recall these sequences. And this all is explained by this asymmetric LTP, and the nature of this asymmetric LTP is the NMDA receptor, right? So I would like to claim, at least, of course, there's always some fuzzy details, but we have pretty good ideas for how sequences can be encoded into to the red hippocampus in this case, and how they can be read out. We know a lot about the underlying neurophysiology, and these effects here can account for the theta phase precession. And of course, over the years, there have been other models for theta phase precession. So this is, I wouldn't say it's by no means proven, but it's still a viable model. There's also another aspect of this model is that, okay, here the rat can predict where it's going, but also by looking at place cell data, you will find that sometimes the rat is not predicting, rather it's encoding for where it just was, right? So it's more like sort of working memory on of its recent locations. And again, this is not inconsistent with this framework. It's more that you have sequences for where the rat just were that is now being represented in these theta cycles. So you might not believe this model work. Nevertheless, there's more recent work in which multiple place cells have been recorded. And when you have these multiple place cells, of course, it's also possible to sort of read the rat's mind. And in order to reconstruct the rat's position, So this is what is indicated here. So this is a given location, and this is the sort of reconstructed position from the rat. And what you should appreciate here from these data is that as the rat is running around, you literally can see these sequences being read out of upcoming locations. So I'm going to make a long story short, and that is to say that at least in the rat hippocampus, there seems to be the machinery for how to represent sequences and also have these sort of predictive recalling sequences. And of course, in the context of this workshop, I would like to extend that machinery and ask, is this something we can apply to predictions during language comprehension? And one very concrete idea would be that you have to slow oscillations theta in the theta alpha band, and then we have different words being represented in the MGL along the face of these slow oscillations. When it's possible to predict, in this case, the last word, you will see that popping up in the sequence. When it's not possible to predict, you will have more sort of a retrospective sequence of the immediate past all represented on these theta cycles or theta alpha cycles. So this is the speculation, but that's something I do believe that we can look into with the right data. It will probably require ideally single unit recordings from humans in the MTL, but it is becoming more and more possible to do this. So I'm going to conclude here. So what I believe is that we have been able to take these MEG data, as I showed you first, and we have some support for predictions or predictive pre-activation going on prior to the onset of a predicted word. Furthermore, it seems like these effects can be localized to the left MTL. Again, take that with a grain of salt, but that is what our MEG data indicates. Furthermore, in order for these predictions to occur, the alpha activity has to be low. However, the fact that the alpha activity is low does not necessarily mean that it cannot exercise a phasic influence on predicted sequences. So the fact that alpha is low is not necessarily in contradiction to this phase coding notion. And then there are some discussion points I would like to bring up. First of all, what is being predicted, right, in these MEG data? We don't know that. So one can discuss whether is it something phonologically, is something more at the semantic level, is the visual word form. We don't know, but it's something we now could explore further by developing the right paradigms. So we would also like to continue our studies. For instance, as you probably would saw, is that the word presentation rate was a bit slow, one word per second. If you would like to speed that up and then see if our predictive effect still holds. Furthermore, we would like to extend this to the auditory modality. We should be able to see the same. A big discussion point here is the MTL. Should it be embraced more in language research? Of course, the sort of going mantra is that the hippocampus is for episodic memory. Maybe that box is too tight. Again, take the work from the rat hippocampus with a rat running around in the maze. After the rat has done that 20 times, there's probably not too much need for episodic memory being involved in the task. Yet you see very strong place fields, you see very strong face possession. So maybe we should extend our notion of the role of the hippocampus and to a larger extent embrace it in language research. And I claim this because, at least again from the rat research, we do know that the hippocampus has this ability to encode sequences and recall sequences and do predictions, and these are really important components for language perception, of course. I'm going to end here by acknowledging the core people being involved in these studies, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Ole. Pascal?
So for your speculation that basically a sentence is encoded in the different gamma cycles of a theta cycle, how would you combine that with the data from David and others that basically the theta during language comprehension seems to be more related to, I guess, syllabic rhythms?
Yeah. So I will not at this stage. Yeah, I mean, so basically, what David is working on is primarily the auditory cortex and say the entrainment by the say acoustic envelope, and maybe there's also some predictive element to this. This might be a very different machinery for how these representations are then. Encoded and predictions is being done, say in higher order language areas and possibly the hippocampus. That being said, I think it would also be very interesting to look at these trait rhythms and what might be going on, say in the MTL, right? But it's all very speculative. So I don't know how to make the link, but it would be interesting to think. In that direction, definitely.
Okay, I saw a hand there.
Can you go back to the first slide with RSA, the RSA data that you presented? Yep, that'll do. Go forward one, yep.
Yeah.
Why is the within pair estimates noisier? So that's the third person that strikes me is,
yeah.
You would think that they would be coherenter. And they're not.
Yeah. So the reason is the following, and that is we have a lot more between pair correlations than within pair correlations. But since we are averaging the correlations, there's not a bias. But to anticipate these kind of criticisms, what we also did was a stratification, where we had the same number for within and between pairs, and we basically saw the same effect. It does. However, we become more robust if we have more between pair correlations being averaged.
Okay, not sure I buy that 100% statistically, but
well, maybe you can sort of discuss this.
But the complementary question of this is for the thing actually at the word presentation. What does the effect look like there? Because you'd expect things that are not prediction but actual observed evidence to have an equally strong or even stronger effect than the prediction. So the things at time zero.
So you mean at this time point here?
Yep.
So you would have liked to see the prediction here, just prior to the word onset?
Not prediction at that point, right? Because once you see the stimulus, you're no longer predicting it, you're observing it.
I'm not sure I fully understand.
So you see an effect of prediction, but you should expect to see that prediction fulfilled or not fulfilled. And so that's at time zero, the observation of the prediction.
Yeah.
So you make a prediction before, and then you see your prediction fulfilled or not fulfilled. So yeah, I'm asking, what's the effect of time at that point? Yeah.
Yeah, so we also see a difference there. So this is basically, it's a bit complicated because remember I told you that in when you can predict baby, in that case we put in child, so we actually do have a slight violation to the prediction. So that becomes complicated to interpret in this light here. So it's something we haven't really looked at systematically, but something we should.
I think you could take that up maybe in the yeah. Pause. I have now, three questions from Lars, Andrea, and Lucia, in that order.
Sorry, I have the microphone, but maybe someone was earlier, I don't know. Oh, okay. So I was hoping something like this would come up, about timescales and all. How does that work with the theta syllable and all that? So I think when we want to think about working memory and predictions, higher level language, right, we have to find a way to make the transition from the delta phrase kind of slow timescales where stuff is actually happening in real time,
yeah,
to the computations that are being done on a different timescale. So temporal compression has to be explained, right, in order to understand prediction in the language system. Can you speculate some more about that? How that temporal compression from the slow rhythms in speech to the fast computations,
Well, I can just refer to the RAT work, where there is a clear temporal compression in terms of predicting upcoming sequences. So you have sequences 5, 6, maybe close to a second ahead of the rat being read out within one theta cycle. So again, that the hippocampus can do this. So I think if you sort of just take that mechanism and slap it on to what's going on in the language network, it at least it's possible. But on the notion of timescales, also what we want to do is to look at the phase relationship. I told you the power of the alpha oscillations modulated the predictability, but the phase we were not able to look at yet. And what complicates this is that we all the time have to compare two sentence pairs where there might be, say, theta alpha oscillations, but the phase of these oscillations could be different. But we're hoping to sort of develop the tool to be able to see if there's a phasic modulation of the predictability with respect to ongoing oscillations.
I was just wondering if you could explain maybe why you have such a long SOA. So 1 second per word is really a long time. And if you have any idea about what people might be doing during that second when they're waiting for the next word.
I don't know. I mean, we were a bit pragmatic when doing this, basically because we wanted to be able to have long enough trials to reliably estimate what's going on in the theta and the alpha band. Okay. So that's where we are coming from. But it admittedly is somewhat artificial, but there's nothing preventing us from speeding up the rate. And the fact that we see these correlations in quite a short time window quite early on, I don't think we will lose anything by going for a more natural speed rate.
For example, did you observe any differences between participants and what the activity in that 1 second interval, right? Because I would imagine that people might be doing a lot of different mind wandering, or that there might be some general anticipation of the onset of the upcoming word because it is rhythmic.
Yeah.
And if
yeah.
that needs to be then subtracted from whatever by condition difference you might have.
Yeah, good point. I mean, so actually what we have hoped to see was some sort of predictability going on prior to the onset of the last word. And we do indeed see that in some subjects, but it's not super consistent. But that's all what now we have the tools for looking into this, and that's what we will do in the future.
Okay. I have one, you know. Did you try to look at temporal generalization instead of the time point by time point correlation that you have now? So what I'm thinking specifically is now you're correlating every, you know, like at time zero, time, you know, t plus one and so on and so forth, but you can also take a temporal generalization approach and look for how, you know, whether information repeats time. And that could probably lead to, you know, because you would expect that the predictions also come a little bit earlier.
Yeah.
Especially in the context when you actually have a predictable time.
Yeah, so that would be like Jean-Remy's kind of method, right?
Right.
So we did, or Lynn, I should say, also did this. And what she did observe was basically sort of a diagonal being somewhat broad. What we had hoped to see was this sort of activity above the diagonal, suggesting there's some sort of working memory trace going on of the predicted words. But we were not able to find evidence for that.
But did you see repetitions over time? Because, you know, like, you don't I mean, it doesn't have to be linear, right? That would be boring, in principle.
Yeah.
You would like to have, you know, like, bursts.
Yeah, so that we didn't really see. We saw the boring stuff, mainly a fat diagonal. But we had hoped for a more rich picture.
I have put myself on the list as well, and then, David, you. I was wondering, do you think that you really need sentences to sort of get this effect? So could you either, you know, only have it with words like, you know, crib and baby, or just have it with pictures of a crib and a baby? So the question is really, what do you think you have been saying about language processing?
Yeah. The way I would put it is that this is, of course, an excellent question. Now we have the tools to address this, but I don't think I should speculate on what is being predicted, whether it's something like visual imagery, word form, or semantics. We don't have the data yet to look into this, but we have the tools to investigate it.
Okay, David?
Just on that last point, your collaborator Gina Cooperberg has done a series of experiments on exactly that, right? So word pairs and picture pairs and the predictive relationship between those. And there, interestingly, the location of the putative prediction effect is, you know, far in the anterior temporal lobe, you know, the upper aspect of STG, so slightly different. But I mean, so Gina has a series of experiments on word pairs jointly with Weber and Ellen Lau. So the work has been done, and it's a good question, like what's doing the predicting there? So, and just one more point on this. I have to say, I also share the concern, and I've voiced it to you before, that the very slow presentation rate makes it extremely difficult to interpret in the context of this,
sure,
because there's just so much going on that we don't. But I wanted to return to the really very fascinating speculations at the end and what Lars is raising about how do you compress the time code? I mean, we understand things, you know, back to the rate issue, it may be, you know, on the mean 4 to 5 syllables per second, maybe it's, you know, when you're 3 words or more per second, it's pretty fast. And then within that, there's interesting structure. And I guess one could imagine maybe that this hierarchically organized structure must be flattened, right, is how it is in the input and output system. It has to be linearized. And then that linearized sequence could be time compressed. And that's actually what could be inserted into the hippocampal representation. So all you end up with is actually, so in the hippocampal representation, you just end up with a cycle that has little bumps on top of it that just tells you A came and then B came. It has no interesting structural information. But that would be a way to take hierarchical structure, squish it down, and insert it in a time-compressed code into a very different representational format that you might use for something else. So it would be an aspect of language processing that's not the core, but would allow you a totally different view of it. It would be extremely provocative if you found something like that.
Uh-huh. I see. Yeah.
Like, right. So, I mean, we've shown, you know, we can. Lots of people have shown it for memory things, but here, if you could do that, it would be the first demonstration of compressing the entire information into something like that in one cycle contains an entire sequence of information. It would be radical, actually.
I see.
Here's a new theory. I don't know whether you have the data yet to show this.
No. I mean, we don't, right? But we might get there. But when it comes to the time compression, like working with these models, I could 20 years ago, right? When we have these sequences encoded, actually the problem was to make the network read them out slowly enough in order to account for the theta phase position or the data. And there, John Lisman's idea was that there's this interplay with the gamma activity, so you have one representation being read out, and then you have a blip of gamma that sort of slows down the sequence readout. So just say, like, from the sort of neural network perspective, the time compression is the easy part. Actually, it's the slowing down the sequence readout that's turned out to be more difficult. So the machinery reads there, as long as you have the sort of the linking being set up, then you just kick it off and it reads out, right?
Okay, we have one more question, and then I think we should get prepared for the photo.
Yeah, so it's just a question about this first study. I might have missed something, but I'm a bit confused about your interpretation that this is a prediction, because in order to claim prediction, it has to be about the word that's coming next. Mm-hmm. But I don't think you rule out here the possibility that it's still about the word that's being presented right now. So at -1, because of the way the experiment is set up, you have to be using different lexical fields for the within than for the between pair condition, right? So why is this not just decoding the word that's presently given to the subject? How can you rule it out?
Oh, because these were very different sentences, and it was just the predicted word being the same.
But in order to build up the prediction, you have to be using different, I don't know how to call this in linguistics. I think we usually call it lexical fields, right? So when you set up the prediction for baby, you talk about cribs and hospitals.
Yeah.
Whereas when you set up a totally different prediction, you talk about different words, right?
So I don't think I'm completely opposed to that interpretation either. It's sort of like the whole lexical context that allows the prediction that might account for the correlation. But I mean, that being said, it was only here for the last word we saw it. We didn't see it building up earlier.
Okay, yeah. I think with this we come to an end, and thank you, Ole. Thank you.
Thank you.